Look at that door, because it's just arrived yesterday.
Sure, I see that it's totally brand new, I understand that, but kind of at this point, what are you thinking about your approach to letting people know about this? Is it gonna let it kind of go organically and?
Well, obviously, social media will definitely get it out that way. The chamber does a monthly newsletter. Yeah, I don't know.
The school's social media too will post that this is live now.
Yeah, but as far, and I don't know, we, potentially in advertising, I think we'll start using that, maybe as the chamber, in addition to the chamber site, we'll list that one also. So, because it is kind of that tourism link too, that gives them some options, so.
That must feel good to get to this point, huh? This is a very.
Especially when you, I mean, obviously there was no portal before, but even like the chamber website was 2007, I think was the last time we, you know?
Yeah, so the chamber website that you link to is all new as well.
Oh.
Same Lime Valley.
The same line.
I mean, this is excellent when you go through and you see.
Well, and for us, the photography was so important. It was just very flash.
So how do you get to that? What's the address?
Chisholm719.com.
I assume that's because somebody else had Chisholm already.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, Chisholm Min actually, like the local newspaper is Hibbing Min. So you type in Chisholm Min and it just takes you to Hibbing Min because they own the same. So Chisholm Min was out. And we had a few different discussions. Mm-hmm. We pulled in Beth from Iron Range Tourism, who does a lot of advertising. You know, and we're like, well, what do you think? She said to do .com as opposed to .org or anything else. So it came down to, I can't remember exactly how we just finally decided on.
Yeah, I think it was just this is our best. Well, I think that, and our web guy said, try this.
Yeah.
Was the suggestion from him, too.
So on the chamber page, when you scroll to those blogs, there's like six. So, like, anytime we post a new one, it knocks off whatever the sixth one is on there.
Sure.
And then they just rotate around. So sure. I think we had, I don't know, the car show was on there. I think that might be off now. The barbecue is still on there.
Yeah.
And the chamber has a raffle on Thursday, so.
Sure.
Anyway, so that's.
Well, without something like this, you're dead for sure, right? I mean, it's kind of like you got at least a compelling.
Well, and kind of like Ethan was saying, too, you know, you get these people that come from the cities or whatever else and want to have these meetings, and they're like, just falling off the grid over here. You know, and so we've kind of really made leaps and bounds as far as how we're able to present ourselves. Yeah, you can come up here and still do your social network. You know, it's really kind of nice to be in that race.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I guess as far as that project goes, we're about 60% complete because we've still got the portal was kind of the biggest chunk. Though the small page, it's still to get everything together. It was a big job.
Make it all work.
Yeah. And so now we'll just have the school and the city to.
And Katie will be talking about city here shortly.
Seeing a business listing. Remember we were in Ely and they said they didn't even have one or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in our business listing, we have the option of, for our directory, of the business itself to have their own web page if they don't have their own website. It's kind of an enhanced feature that we're just going
to. And they can have access to it, which is really nice.
Yeah, they can make their own changes on it.
Right.
So if Adam's Auto Body wants to have a bigger.
They can change whatever they want. And you know what I mean? It really, well, you know. That way they're not waiting on me or Amy or whatever. You know, they can just do it themselves, which makes it really nice.
I don't remember if they have people chamber site on there. Mm-hmm. And then go to directory. I don't remember if they have social media feed options on there too.
If the members do?
Let's click on dining.
It'd be almost cool to have an intern come in and help like
set them up and stuff.
Right. That would be nice.
You know, it's
yeah, because some people can do it, no problem, and some people are
yeah. Right. And we know Black Bear Bakery
they can
has
to their website.
Yep,
so how do you make sure?
Because she shows us donuts most mornings.
Right.
Like, so it's pasty day. We're like,
yeah.
So I just clicked on Valentini's, and it brings them to us to their page with their social media.
So they're mm-hmm. all set up. Yeah.
And a map of where they are. And mm-hmm. my board's falling apart.
Actually. You can blame me. I was. I sort of.
She's off the cheap tape.
It's probably on sale.
Need the duct tape.
Well, this wouldn't be happening if it was PowerPoint.
But you know,
yeah, I think that the website just ran out of money.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah. You know, some communities.
Well, we haven't, but you had to go to their tape budget.
Yeah. Have had, you know, kind of you mentioned interns, Whitney, mm-hmm. and have had success with a young person, you know.
Well, and it kind of fits
going business to business and just sitting down right there and that kind of
doing it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, claim your Google Place kind of, what else do you want to say? Do you like it? What's here? Change it kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Which was, kind of brings us to the technology center that we were looking at, because part of that program was going to be UMD Center for Economic Development has grant funds to put somebody in Chisholm on a part-time basis. And so we felt that was going to be the, you know, they could work individually with the businesses and the website and web presence and that kind of thing. We're not to that point now. The technology center, we had earmarked building that we wanted to use, had the contractor who actually was the owner of the building or the developer all on board, had three tenants all lined up to go in, so that would be nice. They would be permanent anchor tenants, and then the other spaces would be the shared space and the technology portion of it, boardroom type of thing, shared office equipment. But we're having trouble with the developer now. Wouldn't return phone calls to the clients we had lined up, so they went elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And so kind of frustrating, and we're thinking probably are going to not go ahead. There's also a question with out here at Mineland Rec, they may be doing something similar, just in concepts, so we don't, you know, we need to see what we can do, who's doing what, so we're not duplicating it. So that's a big portion right now. We have $34,000 of the grant that's lined up on that technology building, so based on some of the conversations here, we might be reallocating or asking to reallocate some of those funds, see what we come up with. Or we'll do a smaller shared space in a downtown building, because there are a few other options too. And that's pretty much all that I have. I know that Jamie has some things to
add. But before we go to Jamie, though, just one more question kind of about the center. So, talk a little bit more about your vision for that. Was it in, because some communities that are looking at co-working stations, mm-hmm. or was this more of what, talk a little bit more about what you had in mind.
In my mind,
yeah.
it was going to be more of the shared space work center where you could come in and you could lease out a space for a week if you wanted to, or you could take it one day mm-hmm. a week or ever, however you wanted to do that. Some of the tenants, though, would be permanent tenants because it just helps to financially keep it going. There would be a boardroom that would have some higher technology.
If they wanted to use that board, we'd let them. You know, they have to make sure it's not checked out to somebody else. Yeah.
That everyone could use. You would have to reserve that, and then office equipment that's shared by all of the tenants. Yeah. So that's the concept that we had 15 offices in it. But two of the bigger ones would have already been taken. And then our plan was with UMD Center for Economic Development, we were hoping that that person would somewhat facilitate the building. And then otherwise the contractor was going to have his receptionist would be the dates that UMD was not there. They would be facilitating it.
Just so the UMD piece of that fell away?
No, not necessarily. Okay. No. We haven't solidified anything. I know they have grant funds for it. Hasn't come to fruition yet. So, but the two tenants that we did have lined up are now getting
Congrats.
Where'd they go in Hibbing?
That I don't. I will say they were somewhat challenging tenants. I can understand not wanting to make the phone calls, but yet that's something you have to do. Which,
you know, so. Entrepreneurs can become the dealers. So a lot of the examples we see, the Economic Development Agency or Chamber ends up, you know, moving into that building. It's kind of an anchor.
We talked about that.
Yep, we were having that discussion.
Yep.
We just saw that in Ely.
Oh.
They, I mean, they just opened up a new center called 10 Below. It's 10 steps
okay.
Street level, the garden level, and they, plus the weather. But and then Mora is, they've got a fellow work kind of co-working center. The Chamber occupies some of that. Who's, what's the name?
Russ Wagner was looking into it.
Yeah, but it, I was thinking about the Ely group that Harold.
Harold's been involved. So but
Oh, they ended up, okay.
They managed it.
And we had, you know, some of our future plans included a coffee shop in the front of it that was going to be run by high school students. That's why we came up with the name of Business Perks. That's what we were going to call the building. Talked about doing coding classes for the high school out of the building. And, you know, those were going to be step two.
The activity, you know, you might think about what you could do with that $30,000 to generate that kind of activity.
Yes.
You know, because the activity in these centers is a key piece. It's not necessarily the building or technology. It's that facilitated entrepreneurial interaction. You know, the other kinds of things that you're talking about keep things happening. So if those are happening in different types of places, like the library or out here or... But it's not necessarily a permanent location, but you're generating that kind of traffic. That's it. It would be possible to use those dollars to use the fun things rather than real estate.
Sure.
Which then brings us to
Jay. Okay, first off, I'm not contagious, but I do have bronchitis, and when I talk, I tend to cough. So if I throw it to Joe, he's going to panic and run. He knows what we're doing. Okay, he and I are working in deep. Joe and I pitched to IEEE, to Mark Phelps, this last week. We want Chisholm to become a pilot school for new technology on the range. And what we're asking for is in the first year of the project, we want to buy Chromebooks for all grades 4 through 12. And then the second year, we want to put these, Cisco has come out with a new technology kits where the students can be homeschooled, at home, anywhere, and digitally come into the classroom and be present in the classroom. That changes what the telepresence is. You bring the teacher to the kids. Now we're bringing the kids into the building by digital. And there are a lot of different reasons to do that. We want to reach out to our homeschool community according to our MDE Tech, MDE, we have about 30 to 40 kids who are doing online classrooms right now. And we would reach out to them and say, okay, you need a physics class, you can digitally come in. You don't actually have to come into the building. Or if you need an algebra class, come into the building, come in this way. We have seen just this year an uptrend, unfortunately, in doctors diagnosing kids with such severe anxiety, they can't come to school. And we are concerned about that. And this last year we had 5 kids diagnosed with that. For Chisholm, that's a high percent when we're looking at that. If we could get these kids digitally coming in and then continue to work on the social, whatever they need to feel comfortable to physically come back in, we think this would be a bridge for them. The other pieces of it is you have a student, Shannon takes her kids on a vacation, doesn't want them to get behind. And what makes this technology so unique is that you can use any platform. It doesn't need an iPad, you don't need a Chromebook, Samsung, any iOS will work to bring the kids into the classroom. In the demonstration we actually saw a school in Oklahoma using it, and the physics teacher actually stayed home that day because his kid was sick. He digitally came in and taught his class. and was able to, so we, you don't have a drop-off in education if the professor's out sick and that. So we are asking RRRB for some help with that, to bring that in. And I don't know where else you want me to go with this. You and I didn't
well,
really talk.
We talked about coding classes as part of that, maybe in the younger grades, I think you would talk about coding. And maybe that's the use of some of our grant dollars rather than the technology building. Maybe it's going into a program, something like that, to get it started.
We, and when I came from Cass Lake, we had started a coding prom classrooms starting in kindergarten. And we, I had kindergartners through fourth grade in my building, and all of them were taking 7 weeks of coding every year. And that was amazing to watch these little, you know, and it's code.org, and the kindergartners, are, it's by pictures, you know, and draw down, but they're learning to code. And what we had been seeing research-wise was that they were going to need 600,000 coders this next year graduating. No, they needed 1 million, and they thought they were graduating 600,000 in the nation. Coding can be done from anywhere. You can be at home and be coding and writing coding and work from home, which then leads into the economic development. We want to keep kids here. We want them to stay here. We want them to grow up here. We want them to come back here if they do go away for school. We want this to be home for them. And then the other piece is that I know IRRRB told me that there is, what is it, Wasabi? College is offering a STEM program where they're going to bring in kids from all over the nation. They're going to be here for so many months, and they're going to teach them how to learn online, and then they go back to their communities and live and work and do the online. So we would be getting our high school kids ready for more online learning before they hit college. Plus, maybe and some of our PSEO can be still stay in the building. We think this will increase our numbers to get our school up to where we are financially. We will grow our population, and we will be able to begin to support that with a growth in population. You have a deep look on your face.
I'm just, it, so it's a lot. There's a lot to absorb there, and it's just my personal concern about high percentages of families that isolate their kids in homeschooling. I just believe that public education is the crucible of democracy. It's where people learn to be together with people that are different from them. So I'm actually, I'm kind of trying to absorb
see, and I think
the hollowing out. Yeah, so I that really caught my attention. I have a lot of concern about kids isolated in homeschooling situations. And then another thought I had was, well, if I was the, would you say was a physics teacher homesick, maybe wouldn't be that happy to have an option to still teach my class from home when I'm sick.
Well, and if
you know, I mean,
truly
it's just
sick, we don't want them to.
Sure.
And just like if a kid is truly sick,
right,
we don't want them online doing
yeah.
that. But
yeah.
at the same time, this physics teacher had a sick kid.
Sure. Oh, I missed that detail.
Yeah, he had
sure.
a sick kid.
So
I
was
log in.
I was just kind of grappling with
either.
All the implications of technology for education, how we deliver it, and education.
Well, I think it's changing.
Yeah,
I think that
really
we are
is.
In a revolution of change, and Chisholm, one of the things, and this is not a negative at telepresence, okay, I'm new on the range, so I have to walk real carefully on some of these conversations. I think some of that was thrown real big at the schools rather than piloting it, and we want to lead this and say, okay, here's what we learned. Don't do this. You know, Joe learned the other day we had to go get quotes for insurance for the Chromebooks because we are going to have kids take them home. We were just sitting here talking, wonder how much it would cost us to buy hotspots like you guys did at the library
yeah.
that kids could check out and take home.
We'll
you know, what might that might be another avenue of that. You know, and then looking at the broadband connection map, where are we at? Here's Chisholm, all this is not connected. How do we help these kids and how far out do we go? And we have to look at that.
And then I'm just thinking about the decisions you have to make, you know, Chromebooks versus some other, I mean, what a high consequential decision, all those dollars being invested and the fear of making the wrong choice. You know, why Chromebook over something else? You know, it just,
well, Chromebooks are right now the industry standard. When you talk to schools, like, again, I came from Cass Lake, they were investing in Chromebooks for all their kids,
sure.
grades 4 through 12. They were not investing lower than that. iPads still worked well for the little guys because they math programs and that. Chromebooks are inexpensive, and we already have Chrome accounts. We have Google accounts. We have a lot of that already set up.
I wasn't questioning your choice, your decision. I was just in my own mind grappling a little bit with all of the choices that you guys have to make. Yeah.
He's done a lot of research on this and has talked to, he's in a group, a technology group of educators, and they talk a lot about things like this. And we had just started with wanting the Cisco kits, which are about $15,000 a classroom, and Joe came back and said, no, we need to do Chromebooks first. We need to give them their device before then we ask them to lock it. So now we're looking at a couple of year phase here.
Joe, say a little more about the technology group. What is that group?
Of educators.
It's just technology directors from across.
Informally, or is there more of a formal?
Yeah, we meet at the Arrowhead Regional Computer. It's in ARC. We usually meet there once a month during the school year. Once every couple months. And just talk about different issues.
So does somebody sort of own that group or helps keep it going, or is it shared, or how does it work?
It's shared. We pay a fee to be a part of it.
ARC is, our Arrowhead Consulting. We do a lot of all our finances through them. They help us with all of those platforms, and this is something that.
And those fees go into like room rental, and sometimes we get guest speakers and stuff like that. So it's not like it's. I think we pay.
It's not much.
$150 for me for a year. I think it's $150 per person, kind of, unless you have a bigger district. That's important.
Is there a large presence of Iron Range technology people there?
I see Sabi East there, Tibbing, Evelyn, us, Virginia, occasionally.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's not bad.
Are they engaged?
Yeah.
Okay.
You find these tech guys, they all are engaged. I mean, you start talking techy stuff and they're going, and you actually traveled to Wisconsin this year, right? For a.
Yeah, that was for a. But they actually paid for 20 of us maybe to attend the Springstorm Conference in Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. So that was good.
Well, we saw the Cisco investment in Grand Rapids in 318 and 319.
Yeah,
the whole IS. There with it, and I've been in some of those. Many of us on the team have. You been in one of those, Allie? The presence rooms, where you feel like you're supposed to have that experience of being in the room with the people. It is very high end, mm-hmm. for sure.
Right.
I mean, I witnessed a cello lesson being taught in a room like that, mm-hmm. with the teacher and the student. So.
Well, I know in the telepresence this year we. Whether anybody has signed up or not, we did offer Mandarin Chinese because we were asked to find a way to get that on the range here, mainly through our senators. In a meeting with them, they said, we want you guys to get Mandarin Chinese up here. So Reggie over in 2142 contracted with someone in St. Cloud to teach Mandarin Chinese.
Magic wand. It's impressive.
I actually took Mandarin Chinese in high school.
Did you?
And we had a teacher at my school. We had, what was it, ICTG?
Yes.
That kind of went to other schools in the area, and nobody stuck with that more than a week.
Really?
So, yeah, I was like, supposedly you could have like found it on a cable channel on your TV if you had to stay home, but it was terrible. You couldn't understand anything, so I'm assuming that.
The code was all Chinese. Well, yeah, and this technology has, there's two TVs, one in the front, one in the back. And so, always the fear is when kids are going online and stuff that someone else is doing the work for them. Well, with this, they would have their video playing and you would see the student.
Sure.
And you can use any phone.
Sure.
as long as it has the camera in it. You can use any part.
So when you all roads lead to IRRR and stuff like this, and we heard Jenny talk about coming to agencies, so how does this fit with like Roy's work and that whole piece? Is there a...
I mean, that's who they were meeting.
We've met with Roy Smith and Mark Phillips.
And I've had just a brief conversation. Oh, I think, because I'm glad to see, I heard the math, and I'm like, well, there's the feasibility study. How does this fit the kids at home being able to access?
Right.
And I'm just... You're seeing technology be the core of everything, and is there an opportunity to, I guess, leverage that for your community? And I guess it's at a way bigger scale than some of these blended broadband projects are doing, but what is that long-term path? Is it something like that? I mean, I don't...
Mm-hmm. Which is why we're asking to be the pilot school. We think there's going to be pitfalls that we haven't, you know, we want to be able to say, okay, don't do this, do this, try this.
So what is the pilot piece? Because don't other schools have Chromebooks?
They have Chromebooks. We're just behind in technology in
okay.
that way. We're actually doing a one-to-one initiative, grades 4 to 12 is what we're doing with that piece of it. And that was Joe's recommendation, and I learned real early to follow smart guys like his recommendations. But then we're adding the Cisco kits are the expensive part of that, and they're $15,000 a classroom. So we're going to be looking at around $500,000 just.
So that's the pilot piece, the Cisco kits.
Yeah.
Okay.
And how do they work? How well do they work with Chromebooks, or is there something else, or are kids just using their phones?
Sure.
And I'm sure you saw the same. You might have been in the room and I didn't realize it. Where the students, they set up a classroom. And the students, a kid might have a question, I can't find this. And before the instructor can get back to them, the other kids have said, no, you find it on this page. And it becomes a community of learners online. And college are more and more online. I did my doctorate online through St. Mary's. You know, I mean, that is, and we have to teach kids how to be digital learners and community of learners online.
Yes. Really interesting, because we went back and my husband got his bachelor's from Bemidji State online.
Mm-hmm.
For rural areas.
Because I have a library science degree, I drove to Chicago twice a week.
Really?
First semester.
Wow.
That's a pretty big flagship program.
Wish I could have done that.
I know that.
Yeah.
I missed the name, I'm sorry.
The USDA Distance Learning Grant Program is a big source of funds for. And that's how I task
the IS
group. IS group, they've got one or two
$1 million.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Laura really drove the train on that, I think, from
Joe Silko's Laura.
Oh, the EIP.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think that we need to make Chisholm very relevant. I think we can be very educationally relevant and hang on to our kids. And we want to keep them in the community. We want to continue to grow the community. So it's all part of these pieces that I'm seeing as a newcomer on the range.
I keep thinking, too, with our call centers, trying to get more and more people to work from home, just being super technology savvy has to be an asset when you're going into a job interview at one of those places. I don't, you know, just
right.
Some verbal vomit here, but.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the pieces, IRRB was asking me to have a consultant that would.
Right. They want us to have an independent consultant because we do have objectives, measurable objectives, and some of it is increased attendance, increased test scores with student engagement. Just for an example, one as a former teacher, the Chromebooks, they can test the state test in their classroom. There's not any going to the lab, and so then there's more comfortable. It's easier for the teachers to monitor what they're doing right there. That alone should increase a little bit, a few points on that. We're looking at increased attendance. So then we get to count the ADMs of the student when they log in. So we can get money for homeschool kids if they log in for an hour. We get to count them.
ADM is
average daily. Anyway, it's the way the state does our funding.
Got it. It measures the student's presence slash engagement with the school district. Got it. Okay.
Yeah. And we actually get more ADMs for high school students than we do the little guys. So they're financially, I think it will help us. Mm-hmm. You know, Chisholm's in a little bit of a hole here. And I think it will help us. I think we're going to increase students coming to Chisholm. Mm-hmm. And I think that we can continue the historical. Chisholm has always been an education. Mm-hmm. And we need to continue to lead in this field.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's great to see hope, direction, and motivation, and I hope that this team can feel a little wind at your back when there are other people around from the community that see how important this is. Yeah. Did we want to talk about the feasibility study at all? Is that in your guys' participation perspective?
Well, Joe and I don't think, well, Whitney obviously is very involved.
Yeah.
But not everyone here is, but that's, yeah. I
was
out of touch with it for a while. So,
Phil, is there any purpose to talk about it now or anything?
Well, you know, we heard a pretty good update the other last week with that team.
You know, so I was out on maternity leave for a couple months over the winter, and our consultant had really kind of gone back and was doing some of her own work, and the group kind of paused for a while. But she has, we've been kind of regrouping here and meeting, and she's ready to kind of unroll the information. You know, Janie has a copy of just like the draft information right there that we've been looking at. She's gonna do community by community summary pages, and we are going to go out to all the communities and get this information in front of them over the end of August and September when she comes back. So I guess what I'd be looking for from the school district and the city and hopefully Balkan Township is, you know, let's get on a school board or a city agenda, just inform them because they've all invested in this study and here is a path forward if you want to see broadband in the rural households. We've been looking at, you know, the state border-to-border grant was not funded, you know, the model depends on other funding to make this happen in rural areas. We're all aware of that. So just kind of putting some possible scenarios together ahead of those meetings on how a project could actually occur. You know, if it was Balkan Township and it was $10 million and we could identify $5 million in federal funding and then a company is open to doing 20%, so then we're up to $7 million. How do we fill that $3 million gap between the local partners? Whether that's the agency, the county, the school district, the local community is, you know, but some sort of model on how to make that actually happen, because the opportunity is now. Or in the next couple years, if this, you know, if the federal grant doesn't work, how does the state border-to-border program, if funded, fit in there? How do we kind of get a general model going to hit all those rural areas?
Yeah. You start to see the impact now. You know, Delta Dental started a new facility up in Bemidji now, and part of their reason was that anyone within 50 miles of Bemidji can essentially telework because they have great internet throughout that area. They have trouble here in the range, you know, in the Duluth area, getting teleworkers because broadband is so poor in most of the rural savings county. Mm-hmm. You start to see the economic losses, but certainly there's a lot of people who could do those jobs here in this area.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Ethan's nodding, yes. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Especially if you're training your high schoolers as a funnel in for some of those.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And then the future is you are hired by a company out of the state and you're working from home or I don't know.
So that feasibility study, I think people are pretty well satisfied with the results of the work.
Yeah.
I think that's really well done. So now it's really a matter of building the political will here within the communities.
To fill the gap.
You know, there's four or five communities. part of that study and say, well, which one is going to move forward? Which, who has kind of the political will, whether it's a town board or a city government, to make those things happen?
Well, it's a not, what I appreciate about meetings like this is you get a sense of the whole, you know, and all the different touch points, and and it's cool to see how the it's greater than the, some of the parts.
And I just want to follow up, like, for the when the school is going to apply, let's say you apply for that USDA distance learning grant, will they throw in a few extra $100,000 for kind of connectivity to the home? Mm-hmm. So if you look at your lowest income families, and normally they say, well, you know, internet's not available, number one, and number two, if it was, we couldn't afford it. You built in some mechanism where they could subscribe, and suddenly here's now another 50 or 100 subscribers on this network. It makes it a lot more attractive to the telecom provider to have those people signed up. You could say, okay, well, we're going to prepay, we're going to, you know, we're not going to write a check to the individuals for that service, we're going to write a check to the telecom provider and give them a list of addresses. And so that will be, just as you start to think about these other programs to fund the education side, think about how that might support the network.
I see that. And our discussions with a potential provider partner have been, you know, they're willing to look at any of the areas in any of the communities with a 20% investment in the project. But, you know, the more users you get on, maybe the more they're willing to contribute to, or, you know, so it's not like we're gonna go serve all the red areas and all the communities on the map. It's gonna be where the will is to put a project together.
Right. So like right now, Cherry Township seems as engaged as anyone.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, in terms of, they have town board members who attend the meetings and seem to be as interested as anyone, I think. So you might think, well, here's Cherry Township suddenly making a big leap forward because their town board has kind of been talking about it and discussing it. So that's an important thing.
Whereas, I mean, we have a representative from Balkan showing up all the time, but we don't have that relationship with the town board, you know? And
yeah. So one of the things we wanted to do is talk about the future. This is a 2-year program, and it's been 2 years, and we're winding up. And so we're thinking about how we might continue to support and work with you in the future. And as part of some new funding that the foundation was fortunate to get from IRRR to continue doing this work in the Iron Range, we have an opportunity to offer a sort of an alumni program status opportunity to our existing 6 communities, including you guys here in Chisholm. And we talked today about unfinished business and other things that might happen. And so, but it, you know, again, we only want to work with willing partners where you think that there's some benefit here. But if you are interested, we are interested in continuing to partner with you in the status, and that would mean that we would have some additional grant funding available to you what we're asking of our alumni community is we'd kind of reset the program, start over. Bill would come back and have another kind of wide open blue sky meeting, invite a lot of people from the community. It would be another chance to showcase, look what we got done, look what's happened, look what's changed, what else can we do, what can we build on, what else do we want to do. Do that ideation process again and develop projects and then fund those projects. And I don't have in my head how much for that. $50,000 over a 2-year period. And we are going to be bringing on, so as part of this program at IRRR, 4 new communities that we're going to be working with in the Iron Range. And we would bring, and also Kuchiching County is going to hop on and go through the program with this cohort. They're being funded separately by Blana Foundation, but that doesn't matter to you, it's invisible to you. But because they're up here, it kind of creates a nice regional cohort, and they decided they'd like to go through the program with the four new communities that we're in the process of identifying and selecting. So I'll set that aside for now and return to that point. But we expect to have those communities identified, you know, by before the end of the year, have an initial intake meeting. You guys remember when we did that with you and we all came together? We'd like to invite those alumni returning communities to join us for that meeting so you can kind of be the show, start your stuff again and share what you know and learn and that whole thing. And we would invite you to probably do that again at the foundation towards the end of the year.
Can I bring my photo book?
Yeah,
absolutely. We'll lend you a
roll of duct tape. We're going to buy you some Microsoft software.
Bill, do you want to add anything about the expectations to what I said? Or?
No, I think that's right, and I'm not sure whether they have, you know, if they wanted, if they had their vision and meeting and project development, can they allocate their hands on that $50,000 all in the first year?
Yes.
Okay. So that would be, you know, this, we've kind of, I won't say held your hand much, but provide a lot of assistance over the, through the period, but it wouldn't hurt to, you know, experience now a lot of big ideas right here. To try and get that money into the community and working, you know, relatively quickly, I think would be the idea. So,
I feel like it's an opportunity for you guys at the school district to really gain support for your vision. And
We're in.
No, that's great. Because I was just saying, like, the trade complex, level.
And I mean, I don't know if you picked up from it, but from the foundation's perspective, meeting the telecommunication connectivity needs of that HRA, those lower income housing units, is very core to our aspirations, and we would love to see a focus on those, helping those people get.
The thing too with both like the Pocket Park and Kiwanis Park would be the same thing. Right now with HRA, it's the same thing that. Really, the spaces we're looking at are only utilized during the nice months of the year. You know, there's 5 months of the year where people aren't up in the parks. So, you know, we're paying for the connection, but it's not being utilized. So it would be nice to be able to broaden it and open it up to that entire complex. And
that'd be great. I think you think about the, as a school, you think about other sources of money or projects. The idea that what could the school then do to help these kids, you know, get online and make effective use of that internet connection in their homes, whether that's more PCs for people or obviously the Chromebooks would be a big part of that. And so as you think about those kind of things, you can start piecing these things together. And when you go to the funding people, then you're saying, well, we only need 10%. We've got 90% of our vision funded. We just need your 10%. And funders sure like that.
Sure.
You know, that it's not, oh, well, we need 65% of our vision from you. You know, if you have all these other commitments in place, that is really a positive thing.
Right. Well, I kept saying we should take one of our Wi-Fi buses and park it in the HRA, but they had to be students at Chisholm before we'd give them a login just to keep them there. But I got shot. Not being <him.
laughs> Well, as we kind of move to close up, I'd like to ask that we start with you, Jill, maybe, and go around the table.
Can I say one more thing?
Sure.
We're also having a conference in, at Madden's again on October 23rd and 24th this year, and we'd be happy to, if any of you wanted to join us, we'd be happy to send a few free registrations.
Sorry, where was that?
At Madden's in Brainerd.
Oh, okay.
It's our statewide conference.
Got it.
It's not specifically a BBC thing.
Okay.
Thanks.
It gets all the broadband people together, just like you have a library conference. And it's really interesting. I've gone quite a few years now, and I learn a ton every time.
Yeah.
Whitney's a big champion of the Iron Rangers, you know, and she's whispering, I gotta get more Rangers to that conference.
From the library's perspective, so this conference stamp talks about not only the infrastructure side things, but also a lot of the digital inclusion, community technology initiatives that are happening. So Ann Tracy's going to lining up a big digital inclusion showcase with like hundreds of presenters. But so there's a lot of different, you know, for the technology people, it's interesting to want to know about fiber networks.
Yeah.
And then for the users, there's all kinds of great information about economic development, healthcare, education, and so on.
Okay. And it's a nice time of year to be at Madden's, and it's a beautiful place. So
okay.
Could be hot, or could be snowy.
Yeah. Okay, so Joe, so just say a few words about something that you feel really good about that's happened as a result of your work on the project.
Well, the Wi-Fi on the buses. The kids don't waste time when they're driving 2 hours to International Falls, you know, and 2 hours back. We give them the opportunity, you know, with Wi-Fi to school work. You know.
My coaches have them looking at game film on the
and I just think that's great that we're giving them that.
It's great to see the expansion. You know, because sometimes we fund projects and it's for two buses for a year or 2 years, and then at the end of 2 years, we can't afford that, or wasn't that nice. But to see you guys and say, this has been worth it, let's do more.
We actually have to pull one out because the lease is done with that bus. So we're reinstalling that.
Nice.
Okay. Yeah. So we got 32 on the way.
I think for me personally, it's been fun to be involved in the project because it's helped me get involved with the community, get to know people, and be part of representing the school. Mm-hmm. It's just been great.
Well, that's really good to hear too.
And it's exciting to see kind of this new emphasis on technology in the schools.
Right.
You know, and so we kind of, when we do this, we talk about instilling this culture of use, the idea of let's infuse a lot of things you do with technology. So it's exciting to see the leadership of the school district. We'll take this much credit. I'm sure a lot of that goes in a lot of directions, but it's exciting to see that happening because if it's a tech-savvy school, that reaches into so many other parts of the community.
Castlake's loss was Chief's gain.
I don't know if they did that, but okay.
How about you, Amy?
I'd also say the connections that I have made working. I think, I can't think of one person at the table here anyway, and a lot of the others that I haven't called on for something not related to broadband, but just because I've made that connection. Some of them are like, yes, probably. yes, so those connections are great. Personally, the PCs for People just gave that really happy, I'm really doing something. The looks on those kids' faces and the parents went, really, I get a computer. You know, that was just, it's cool.
It's fun, isn't it?
Yeah.
Today is the 10th anniversary of PCs for People.
Oh, wow.
Ann and I were at their little celebration this morning, and we got in the car and drove excessively fast. You know, from when we started working with PCs for People now, probably 10 years ago, you know, there they did like 1,000, you know, that was the first year they had 1,000 computers, and we were a big share of that, I think, you know, and now 10,000 computers a year they do, and now they're
nationally
going to open their fourth office now.
Yeah, it's hard to just pick one thing. I mean, the portal, I think, is going to be excellent for the community, but every time something was done, completed, that was great.
Yes. I know the completed on your board.
Well, I was just reflecting a little bit. I've been back on the Iron Range about 4 years now, and to be able to see, you know, I work in community development for an economic development organization, and so often it's hard for traditional economic developers to see the role in, you know, creating an environment that creates jobs and that kind of thing. So I'm always pushing stuff up a mountain. So when I can come to these meetings and I can see, oh, my work in the downtowns helped the pocket park happen, and the work with the broadband communities has helped, you know, this this building have better connectivity, and I'm really starting to see the impact that some of my work has had across the Iron Range, so it's been really rewarding. And I came here and I was just feeling a little overwhelmed, like, what am I doing? And then I come to these meetings and I feel good. So you guys got me on an emotional wave.
Nice.
I guess the most exciting part for me was just having the opportunity to be one of the first libraries in the Arrowhead system to be able to offer the mobile hotspots. Kind of the pilot program for that as far as the Arrowhead system, and when we go to the meetings, all the librarians are asking, you know, how are the hotspots going, and be able to offer advice on how they're going with that is pretty good. So,
what makes me feel good for you is your work on the portal. As someone that has tried to herd a bunch of cats into getting their ducks in a row for a portal project, it's tough work, and that you have it up and there's buy-in is big. So congrats.
I think for the Discovery Center, we're just happy to be able to be a connected community gathering place now, so that when we you know, try to partner with a lot of different community organizations and you know, use our spaces to hold community events, that we have the capability to have a connected event now. I think that's just, it makes us feel good, and we're able to better help with those community partnerships in that way.
So I have the privilege of getting to see, you know, a lot of communities. We've worked in a lot of communities so far, and what is most rewarding for me personally is just, I get a sense that the people who participate feel like they feel like they can get stuff done. You know, that it's sort of a sense of, well, the fancy word for it from my graduate degree would be efficacious. You know, people feel like it matters, like it's making a difference. And just that kind of intangible sense of, we're a team, look at us, we're cool, we're a team, we got this done. I like that feeling that I get when at the end of these projects. And I feel that here today. Like, you guys felt like, look at what we did. We made a difference, so that's rewarding for me.
Well, with this entire round, it's the first time I've sat through it from, you know, initial steering team meeting to today, and it's been great to see the whole process all the way through and get to know people a little bit better and kind of see projects instead of just seeing them in the idea phase and the end product. It's really great to on the ride and see what everyone's good work has done, because, you know, most of our communities have been fairly successful, but it just kind of means more when you kind of see
it. I've worked up, you know, now I think we've completed 36 communities, and it's always a lot to learn at the beginning. We have folks on a team like this, and whether it's discussions about broadband or intelligent community and Blandon and the process, a lot of, you know, heads are spinning, maybe eyes are spinning a little bit from the amount of work and the amount of knowledge that people are trying to get about what we're trying to do. But it's always great at the end now, especially with this alumni program, thanks to Whitney, is that it's, you know, do you want to do more? No, we've kind of done that, we're moving on to something else. And this is so integral now to the community, whether it's digital inclusion, or the connectivity, or workforce, that we're really, I think we're in a good spot to what the program we're delivering. And, but if you have ideas about how we can do it better, easier, smarter, we'd sure love to hear that too.
Yeah.
But tell me first.
So I guess next steps are stay tuned for. Oh, Anne, I know Anne. Did you want to add?
I'm just so excited because I know after this meeting, somebody's going to show me the best view from this building.
Nice. Yeah. I guess next steps are to Mary will be in touch with you on dates, and she mentioned the conference, and then we'll have this in-gathering. And I guess at some point, Amy, if you huddle the wagons, whatever, and just, I mean, we got the sense today you guys want to do this, right? Mm-hmm. Is there any more? So we'll just assume, unless we hear otherwise, that you're in.
Leftover dollars.
Whitney, what's the time?
I just want to see community-supported projects that, you know, make sense.
So since we already granted it, that's really, okay, yeah, it's, you know, whatever makes sense.
Yeah, we want to work with the communities to do the best project within the limited resources.
You know, it would be great if you could get it spent, or a plan in place in the next few months and spend it. You know, it's kind of a lot of money.
Yeah.
Come up with projects that you can get done. And, mm-hmm. I mean, you're going to be working with us anyway, so.
Yeah. And I think what we want to probably do is do that visioning meeting, even though we're not totally done with our other projects, because we're not sure which direction to go with that now that we're not maybe doing the technology building. I want to have that visioning group back. Here's what we've done. We still have this money to spend and potential for this money.
Right.
What do we want to do?
Yeah.
And we could still do that this year, right? I don't see a reason.
Yeah, as soon as any time, really.
Nothing to keep in mind is, you know, up in Ely, Bill mentioned 10 steps, 10 below, and mm-hmm. I got an email this week from Ross over in Aiken County, where we're going to be later this week, tomorrow, that they're looking at doing something, and, you know, so there's, you know, lots of other people to learn from mm-hmm. who are trying to fight this.
Yeah, see what they've done.
Yeah. And we could even, you know, open to having organizing some kind of a tour or meeting or conversation to get people from across communities that are looking at centers or co-working spaces to share. I know just we were sharing, Bill and I, some resources with Ross just this week because they're kind of asking questions. So that's part of our theory, is that the cohort thing helps, that you guys can help one another as you go through. So.
Sure.
Good.
And one final thing, I guess I didn't mention. Bertie mentioned that we're kind of writing an assessment for over the last year and a half, 2 years. If you have any good photos or quotes that you could send my way, I'd appreciate it.
From your board! You got quotes on there. There's right here. There are some good quotes right here.
Oh, I
recorded
your
answers.
Oh, okay.
Can I use that?
Sure.
Are you comfortable with that?
Yeah. Okay.
Glenn
likes
people pictures.
Yeah.
The story, and then
do you have
like
all of our Ranger articles that we've done on all the different projects?
Yeah, look them up.
Those are good.
The info team has them all, so I think I can forward those to you.
Oh, sure. Yeah, if you could forward, if I didn't have to like go find them.
I have a majority of them.
Yeah.
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 It's nice I could make this one.
Yeah.
I'm busy.
That was the hardest thing for me starting this. You walked into my office,
yeah,
and went through, and understanding what's a gigabyte, what's this, what is